Should we start?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll start? All right. Okay. A warm welcome to everybody. Thank you so much for coming in here and the co-panelists here. So today's session is the last panel of the day. What? It's not working.
It is.
Yeah. So today's is last panel, and it is titled as Everyday Intersections, Haptic Humans in the Digital City. Now, the whole idea of this session was to re-examine not just the relationship of how technology has redefined us living in the cities, but in many senses, to actually to relook at technology itself and sort of reconfigure how technology can be re-examined at one level. So in a way, what we would like to look at is the life of the technology itself. On the other hand, the other papers address to this living, or how the technology has enabled of being in the world. And when I say enabled, it's not as if we are looking at this divide between the city and technology as a divide, but there being a flow between the technology and the humans in itself. So the idea is to explore these kinds of haptic experiences, the flows between the technology and the humans, and how they have become an integral part of being in the city. So our first presenter would be Solomon Benjamin, Bhuvaneswari Raman, Prasad Shetty, and Rupali Gupte, and I'll just ask them to introduce themselves and go ahead with the individual papers.
My name is Bhuvana, and I work in the area of broadly in the area of urban studies. And today's presentation is part of a larger project looking at India-China urbanism and the trade flows between two cities. It looked at three cities: Delhi, Chennai, and Mumbai. And what we'll be presenting today is the findings from Mumbai. And tomorrow we'll look at the other two cities.
Solly Benjamin here at IIHS, and as Bhuvana mentioned, we've all been part of this project over the last couple of years, and part of the project is also in the slideshow and some of the films that are located just outside in the lounge area. So you can have a look at some of the films that these are not sort of posh professional level films, but it'll give you a kind of sense of what we've been doing through an exploration. Thank you.
Do you hear us, Solly?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is Prasad Shetty. This is Rupali with me. She is both of us are me. Rupali and me are both teaching at the School of Environment Architecture in Mumbai. This is so as Bhuvana said, today we speak about Mumbai, the Mumbai case. This work was located in four cities and four specific places in cities, which were these so to say electronic markets in these four cities, and Solly keeps on calling them China Bazaar also for reasons which we discuss through our presentations. So this one, the Bombay case, was located at Lavington Road. And so this is a series of kind of studies undertaken to kind of look at many things, to look at the relationship between enterprise and space, to look at how space kind of structures enterprise and enterprise structure space, to look at the connectedness of various aspects of the enterprise, to look at the spatial consequences of such connectednesses, to look at also how human beings and their lives and their thoughts and their aspirations get structured through being parts of this enterprise, as well as how the space and the enterprise structures human life and their aspirations. So as we did the study, this kind of study kind of opened up many dimensions more for us, and some of the important kind of our which framed our own thoughts and thinking on the city also got structured. So just to quickly kind of go through Lamington Road, this is somewhere in the south of the city, the old part of the city. This is the historical, historically it was a market of recycled goods. Also, it was later became an automobile spare part kind of a street. This is the main street, and today it sells computer parts, lights, mobile repair shops, various kinds of electronic goods, sound systems, etc. We'll do this presentation in four quick categories, quickly. The first one we are calling it the spatial intensities.
So like you saw the previous map, just go back to this. You'll start seeing that there are a series of intensities that get mapped on to Lamington Road. If you see these series of, you'll see series of these overlapping activities. And if you actually just go like one step, one street down here, you'll find this, an absolutely quiet neighborhood. And this is predominantly what this neighborhood used to be. It was a kind of a place with comprised of chawls, and then slowly you'll find that a lot of these series of activities that you start seeing in the map start penetrating into this built form of the chawl, and so we talk about this kind of intensity as we go along. These are some of the details.
Basically, talking also of the movement of goods, human beings, communication, information through various kinds of spaces in the neighborhood.
So, for example, you would find that this is actually an old printing press. But then the way property works, there is this shop which just occupies the front. It's almost just a 3 foot wide shop that has carved itself out into this mill structure. Some of the by lanes, and then you'll find that the edges, so this is a residential building behind, but a lot of these edges start corroding, and you'll find that the Lamington Road starts locating itself in this corrosion. Things happen at various scales. So, for example, this is a cupboard shop, which is hung on to the building behind, and in some ways there is a relationship between what happens ahead and what happens here. Sometimes there is a nominal rent that is paid. Sometimes there is another kind of understanding between them. So you'll find these kind of series of properties that start unfolding.
Just a small footnote. I mean, this is a perfectly legal, complete, shop actually. And this one, because of the Rent Control Act and various other policies of which has kind of, which got layered in the city of Bombay, this is not in no terms this is anywhere temporary or informal or anything. This is a perfectly legal formal shop, this one.
And you will find that, so for example, this is what we call the day and night shop. So when the shop, this is in the evening, sometime when the shop started closing. The light over here is, this was not the evening, but this happens in the evening as well. This is a time when the shop was closed for whatever reasons. And then this shop in the front started getting activated. So you'll find that this person comes and sits most of the times in the evenings, but also at times when the shop behind closes. So you'll find that there is never a kind of straightforward relationship between one shop and the street, but these kind of multiple occupancies that start occupying this. Yeah. So this is a Chol's house, and you'll find that similar to the first slide that we saw, this is a Chol where the front, the living room has now become a kind of shop that sells computer peripherals, and the storage above. So you'll find that there are a series of modifications that start happening to the residential structure. And then you'll find signages like that. It's the laptop repairing. And the shop that kind of goes with this is a shop that is actually under the staircase. And you'll find that the series of signages that then lead to places, because traditionally you only had shops on the ground floor and houses above, but now you'll find that the commercial activities, the workshops start occupying various spaces, and then you'd need to have things like that to actually find them. And then we went through, this is the second series, which is called Connectedness. And what is interesting is the way you start seeing a kind of, so a shop will never work by itself. You'll find that series of shops that start getting connected to various dealers and to the larger enterprises, the larger distributors around. So for example, just to give you one of these examples, there is this shop which is connected through a Betaphone network to the rest of Lamington Road. And so you often find that there are cartons lying outside, or really tiny shops which cannot occupy, which cannot actually store all the stock required. But what they often do is keep empty boxes outside just to make sure that, let people know that they have the material required. And then you will find that a customer is never sent away. You will find this person calling another shop and getting the material from them. So it's all connected. It's one big Lamington Road, often is one big shop. And then there's a series of transport networks that actually connect them to other cities.
And transport networks within Lamington Road also. But I like this this imagery behind.
And they're often connected through various associations. The series of support networks. So for example, you will find that this is to zoom in, there is the REI Polytechnic. And this is a place that actually teaches people how to repair mobile phones. So that is the network, the institution from inside. And this used to be historically a radio electric institute. So you'll find that here it says April 1940. That's when it began. And this was a time when people used to, there'll be some place where they'll write that the Victoria will come and, you know, pick you up and things like that.
Yeah.
The library. And so slowly you'll find that this radio electric shop has now morphed itself into a place that teaches people how to repair mobile phones. And then series of bookshops. You'll find that Lamington Road is full of these kind of bookshops. And you often talk to the people who are repairing the mobile phones there, and they will tell you that, you know, it's, they've got their knowledge through picking up books like that from the road shop, from the shops around. And then series of cinema theaters. So there's a huge kind of support network that this is actually a water tank. So series of networks that actually bring water, the recycling industry, and this is the building industry. So for example, you'll see that this is a shop that is being set up, and this happens on Fridays. That is because second Saturday is a holiday for the municipality, and so you invariably find that these shops start getting built on the Friday before.
Prasad, unfortunately, 3 minutes more.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think so. So this is the BMC ward. I mean, there is a license that this person is displaying. But again, series of re-engineering networks. So you'll find that this person is Anna. He's a collector, and he collects all kinds of old motherboards and other things. This is our.
Pradeep, we'll come back to it. Actually, we'll come back to Pradeep a little in a while. But the whole thing is that. The human body and the material and the networks kind of, you know, and when we went to speak to them, they were very snobbish because they realized that we were not kind of interested in the material but in something else actually. So then we took Solly, and there is a whole story that opened up later. This guy has been there on the streets last 25 years. He's this massage guy basically. So he gives tail massage and body massage and stuff like that. And you find this kind of you talk to him, and then there are various stories that he opens up. He roams around the whole place with this towel and this chair and his massage oils. This landowner over here who kind of, you know, who's rented a wall of his shop to a lottery services to run the lottery systems. These are three friends who have been meeting, you know, they own these three shops, and they have been meeting, it works as three different shops, but one owner who's kind of, you know, who's constantly seen chatting with each other in the whole place. This shop is super interesting because this is kind of, you know, this is this camera shop actually, camera and specializing in camera, and he has all kinds of spy cameras that he collects. He likes collecting them more than selling them because, you know, it's more of and if you go to him late in the evening or very early morning when the shop is less busy, he kind of starts speaking about, you know, the pen cameras and the spectacle cameras and all kinds of cameras that he's been collecting.
This will just end very quickly with this last story. And this is Pradeep, who is 70 years old, and one of the he repairs sound systems. And he realized that the repair business was actually dying down. There's a previous slide which showed how the printed circuit board is now becoming such that the components are becoming smaller and smaller, and it's very difficult to now repair. So what he does is he's kind of divided his shop into two parts and rented one little part to one of his friends. But then now he's almost become a part-time designer. So this is this part, this is the shop that he's rented. And he's put a little mirror here, which comes from his bicycle, which is his surveillance device. So people coming in and out of the place, he kind of looks after. And so this is this map that he's done where a Marwadi gentleman actually came to his shop and told him how he's such a fool to have a shop like that in Lamington Road because he's never going to make money and it would be much better if he sells it off. But then he says, you know, he stays there because he enjoys it. And that's where we actually started looking. These are a series of things that he's designed, a dial for his watch, pens crafted out of the acrylic pieces that are hanging around in his place, pens that are made out of brass pipes, and series of iterations of that. That is the last slide. He has some 27 of these. And what was then interesting for us to formulate was the fact that it's really the fact that a lot of Lamington, it wasn't only Pradeep, but series of people in Lamington Road who had another trip. Right? And that's something that we often do not think about. You know, how does one, that the city is not something that is only worked in, but is also enjoyed. And that's something that actually started unfolding to us with the Lamington Road study. This is something we are now working on to take further in our research.
That's what, and now wherever we see trips all over, trips of people all over the city. history, actually, all people having some trips. And it appears that the city is basically run because of these trips of people. Otherwise, there is no reason why the city should run. Thanks, that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Prasad and Rupali. Now we will move on to the next speaker, Kriti Kanaujia, who will be speaking on untouching with touch, Homo haptics interfacing the digital city.
Point two.
Hi, good evening everyone. I'm Kriti Kanaujia and I'm a PhD scholar in Department of Geography, Delhi School of Economics. I usually don't work on this theme, but somehow it struck while I was browsing through this conferences, you know, call for papers. So I'll get right on to it. So I'm going to present on Untouching with Touch, Homo haptics interfacing the digital city. So I'm using untouching, un/touching because in the contemporary era, well, we have become more tech savvy. We have actually reduced our physical touching. So we are touched in the way that we are using haptic technology, which is touch technology. All your smartphones work on touch. So you're touching the screens all the time. People are a touch away. Your communication, your connections are just a touch away. And I'm using the word homo haptics. So if anyone has done their 10th or 12th, they'll know that human species is scientifically known as Homo sapiens, the wise man. So I'm actually looking at homo haptics, which is the next evolutionary step in this, from the Homo sapiens to the homo haptics. So I'll get on to it. We are living in a contemporary urban scenario in which, you know, the world is going more and more towards urbanization. Now this urbanization is more digital centric. It's more technological, you know, based on more interconnectedness, based on nodes of networks, based on connections. It doesn't work on just saying, you know, just because this infrastructure is there or this skyscrapers are there, this becomes urban. The urban has been redefined in the technological era as the place where there is a presence of intense networking. Intense networking in terms of communication, in terms of transportation. So there is a kind of space-time compression that is being talked about in the digital urban. Now, like if I can give few examples, like, you know, cinematic scapes or movies such as Elysium, Total Recall, The Jetsons, which was an animated cartoon series, which showed us a futuristic urban city, city based in skies. People were using, rocket cars, so to say, and traversing, and then they were talking and communicating with each other over the internet. And this was the Jetsons came at a point of time when internet was not there. So it was quite futuristic in its imagination and depiction of what a desirable urban would be in the 2000s. So the imagination and desire of future inhabitation is urban dominated and digitally integrated with no space for rurality. So as you can see, I've mentioned that even if a rurality exists, it exists as sort of like an open air museum just to remind us what was rurality all about. Or in this technological era, rurality can also be assumed to be a space or a place where there is a less concentration of networks. So there is less connectivity or you have connectivity issues. So this digital urban city or the imagination of digital urban city is premised on interconnectedness of the networks of information, communication and technology, which has resulted into a microcosmic temporal and spatial reality, one which is heterotopic. In both spatial and temporal contexts, as contemporary world exists as much in the absolute space as in the digital space, simultaneously and without breaks. Now the breaks do happen. So like for example, at New Year's Eve, WhatsApp failed, apparently because Indians were sending too many messages, WhatsApp cannot handle it. So apparently even WhatsApp can crash. Indians crashed the WhatsApp, basically. So you have this kind of splintering urbanism. What happens when a critical communication app crashes? You know, WhatsApp is somewhat used by even businessmen. Nowadays, businesses happen open WhatsApps. Documents are sent over, bills are sent over. You are connected to your family networks on WhatsApp. I mean, there is like a huge array of family groups or friends group or whatever. So, So digital urban revolution was intensified with the advent of mobile phones in the 21st century. The mobile phone was mobile and fixed, unanchored, freedom empowering, and representative of the person and identity. So mobile phone was basically a piece of communication technology which was also connecting people, both networks and people. And it was just a touch away. So you were just pressing a button to communicate with a person and you were just pressing a button to connect with a person. I think Nokia also said connecting people. So, and with the advent of mobile phones, there was this new codes of conduct and societal norms that came into being. Something like, you know, the practices of using mobile technology. This also resulted in creation of heterotopic spaces, wherein physical space remaining constant, spaces of relationship, spaces of communication, spaces of touch, and spaces of interpersonal dynamics were compressed with a touch. So the furthering of this revolution was intensified by mobile, internet, and smartphones. In the wake of all this, the digital present is smart, efficient, and more inclusive and integrated into the daily lives and everyday practices of the citizens. So you can see from this slide what all we actually do these days with the internet, with the smartphone, and with the advent of the mobile technology that is there. So the biotic human and the abiotic technique, integration is more intense, frequency, it is more frequent, and it is progressing towards the technique self. So the human being is more technological, or the integration is somewhat a technique man. So the contemporary era is marked by an active discourse around the technical human and passively around the digital city. Because what has emerged is, these days we are connected with anything, like if you are using a particular utility like an electricity consumption app, you know, they are there. So for example, if you're using a Dakshin Haryana Bijli Vitran Nagam Limited, which is South Haryana Electricity Distribution Corporation's website, it gives you a particular user ID and password. It doesn't give you a locality, it is not generalized, it is catering to your needs for a specific basis and to the specific you, and it is customizing its operations for the individual, not for all of you. So even if everyone is using the app, there is an individualized and customized experience of the usage of the app. So the digital city, as I said, is individual centric. It is premised upon untouching. You are not conversing with the personnel directly. You are being interfaced via a website or the interface of the digital. Like even right now when Prasad and Rupali were communicating with us, they were interfaced with the digital medium. We are able to touch them in a way that we can see them and hear them, but we are not able to physically touch them in that way. So there is an untouch. So the interpersonal now is more mechanical, technique-oriented interface and is exclusive of the physical touch. So these days, to stay in touch or keep in touch, you know, it's very old, but these days it's now even more untouched because of the haptic touch technology, which has evolved to be an extension of the biotic human being. So the phone is actually an extension of you. These days most of the people are with their phone. Like, it would be an enormous social anomaly if somebody is not with their phone. So it has also become as a sensory extension and as a means of staying connected and touching others. Contemporary haptics is an even more mimetic reproduction of the senses, which is simultaneously a place and placeless conception. So even if you're placing your touch on a smartphone, you're actually not touching, you know, you're actually not placing your physical touch on someone, but yet you are still touching them. So the touch has now evolved as a composite sensorium, as it allows one to see, hear, smell, taste, and be touched. This is experiential as well as compressional because it is compressing the temporality and the tangible spaces, one that can be transgressed in seconds or even in nanoseconds. So how do we place touch spatially? Is it real time or is it in digital space? Is it simultaneously or is it something alternative to reality? Or is touch mediating in manifestation of the self vis-a-vis the other? Does touch establish identity? Is touch an active presence of absent beings? Mm-hmm. Or just a means to fill otherwise physically absent entities and space without the real presence? Smartphones have evolved to be active existential aid in manifesting presences of absent beings. Smartphones provide us with mobile numbers, which actually translate into mobile identities because these days everything is connected to a mobile identity. If somehow you lose your phone or you have to change your number, then that is another problem that you have to deal with these days, which was not there before. So, okay. So, what happens when the digital becomes human or the human becomes digital, and how we are being touched by technology and how is technology touching us? So emerging Homo haptics, it is an evolutionary stage wherein the technique and human exist in a symbiotic relationship performed through the sensory of touch and interface by touch while remaining physically untouched. So it is at the level of microcosm, it is at the level of the body, the embeddedness is at the level of the body of the individual being, leading to a transient being wherein one exists simultaneously in the real as well as the digital world. As intangible virtual representation of the absolute tangible self. I'll skip the examples, I'll just go to conclusion. So I was also looking at Aadhaar as to how it has brought in a digital urban citizenship irrespective of, you know, whether you're urban, rural, or you have any, you know, socioeconomic biases or differentiations. How it has somehow become a generalizing factor, so to say. So what happens, like recently there was news of Aadhaar data getting breached. So it was easy, you know, you get a login ID and you can easily access hundreds and thousands of Aadhaar data. Now the problem is that when we are integrating Aadhaar at the level of PAN cards, bank accounts, mobile numbers, what happens if, what would happen, or the intensity at what would happen to the virtual identity of the being? Because if somewhere, somehow this data gets breached, all and everything that you have on the digital will go away and it will impact your real life as well. Because your bank accounts are being now connected with Aadhaar. And something like this kind of vulnerability is more intense in this Homo haptics era, because the level of penetration that this has is quite at the level of microcosm. It's quite intense and it's quite frequent. So I'll conclude by saying that, you know, Homo haptics are as much part of the physical city as they humanly traverse every day, as they are of the digital city that they continue to traverse nonstop and by their haptics. Online is an active reinstatement of the Homo haptics, while offline is a passive existence. Homo haptics are upgradable, like if we buy a new phone, so we can upgrade ourselves. They are downloadable in the sense we can always download software updates to upgrade ourselves. And they are modifiable in the sense that we can always change apps or install new apps to, you know, stay in touch better and effectively with people or in you know, in with the need of the times of the need or need of the time, whatever. So, and all this is just possible because of a sensory of touch, which is a composite sensory in this sense, because it allows you to see, hear, smell. In the case of food blogs, I mean, you cannot smell, but they are describing how it tastes and smells. So you can do that as well and taste. And touch has emerged as one of the largest evolutionary characteristics of the Homo haptics, in which, you know, you are touching everything, but you are still remaining untouched at the level of the physical. So I end my presentation with this, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Kriti. We almost feel like cyborgs. So we can move on to the next presentation, Vivek Tripathi, who's going to speak on haptic interfaces and digital love relationships in urban India.
Yeah. Myself Vivek Tripathi, and I am a PhD research scholar in the Department of Geography, Delhi School of Economics. And it is also like Kriti, it is not my PhD topic, but it is quite a topic which I was very much interested in. And this my presentation is also like an extension of Kriti's presentation, wherein she was discussing about the touch, the haptic humans. And I am not looking into all the directions, but particularly how the media, the haptics, is playing a role in developing, in promoting or progressing the relationships, the love relationships and the sexual relationships of ourselves. And as Kriti said, that there is no doubt that the deeper insertions of digital in our daily life, which has become a digital extension of ourselves, and this extension is in the terms of expression. So how we are expressing ourselves, this expression is very vital to the to a relationship, and it gets portrayed through the mediums of virtual and the physical. And in modern society, the virtual has become more prominent in comparison to the physical, and it the both of the spaces connect each other. If a relationship is developing in the virtual space, it comes into the offline or physical space, and vice versa. So the, when Freud has said that the fulfillment of the human instinct is very much important, and the desire, fulfillment of the desires, is the happiness. So these desires, which were earlier suppressed due to the physical barriers or social barriers, social rules and regulations, has been unfurled by the digital space, which has given the people an emancipation in form of forming different types of multiple relationships, transcending all the physical barriers, social barriers. So this haptic communication has provided each of us an unfettered access to others and an opportunity to explore one's sexuality in the virtual world sans any liability and fear of facing denial. So here the touch has become a very essential attribute of human life that reinforces our senses of our being in this world. To feel touched, or the touch is the medium of feeling our existence. The absence of feeling of a touch is like disconnection from the world. नॉर्मली हम कभी देखते हैं कि हम कोई चीज़ देखी है अचानक से बहुत ज़्यादा शॉकिंग हो गया, हम दोस्त से बोलते हैं मुझे पिंच करियो, मैं देखना चाहता हूँ कि मेरा लोकेशन, मैं हूँ, वास्तव में सपना तो नहीं देख रहा हूँ. सो टच इज़ लाइक एन अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ अवर प्रेजेंस एंड लोकोमेशन ऑफ अवर बॉडी. सो द टच एट ए हार्ड स्क्रीन ऑफ ए मोबाइल फोन अराउजेज द कनेक्शन एंड फीलिंग थ्रू आउट द बॉडी एंड विदाउट कमिंग द डायरेक्ट कॉन्टैक्ट विद द अदर पर्सन. But we are feeling, and the expression of ourselves is very much prominent. It is like we are in physical space while we are touching that phone, the touch screen of that phone. So the communication goes through distant physical touch of our touch screen environment, and communication goes through distant physical touch over touch screen gadgets to emotions of our human body. And this interface is the haptic communication. The connection of this physical touch through our phone to the connection with the other person. So this next. So now we are second point comes is the commodified relationships and the haptic communications. Normally in earlier times, what used to happen is that the topics of love, family, these used to be very simple. And the people, young generation particularly, they were not very much tension about, okay, whom I am going to get married, who will be my life partner, etc. These things, our guardians or parents used to normally have this those responsibilities. But in the modern times, the people are spending years of the years, and they are choosing different people, they are connecting to them, and they are choosing, no, this one should be my partner, this one should not be my partner. So this different type of formation that has arrived is only been possible due to the haptic communications development. So in this case, if you look at the metropolitan cities like Delhi, Mumbai, these areas, people find multiple options to choose their romantic and sexual partners through their smartphone applications and social media. So there are multiple applications which are running inside our mobiles, and we are communicating through them to the people whom we are sitting beside, but we were not earlier able to connect with them, and we are now connecting through these applications. Zygmunt Bauman also contends in his book Liquid Love that the self-centered society and the individualism has liquefied the stabilized and secure relationships of earlier society. So in, according to him, he says that like a liquid which cannot be controlled, it flows in every direction. So when we get the options, so the one relationship, that monogamous relationship, gets into the multiple types of relationships. The smartphone and computer assisted love relationships, these have transformed the meaning and processes of the relationships also, and they have developed it like a game. Like if you are using an application like Tinder, so you are just flipping different types. No, this is not good. Okay, flip. Okay, this one. Like we are choosing our contents in a game. So the relationship has become developed like a commodified, like a PlayStation. It has become like a game in a reality. And recently a research was conducted by a Pew Research Center wherein it said that 62% adult internet users are internet users. And everybody, like Kriti was saying, that everybody now has a phone, a smartphone particularly, and everyone is connected through internet. And the long distance relationships also have been developed and are maintained solely on the basis of this haptic communication. And various applications like WhatsApp, Hike, Snapchat, etc., smartphones, let them connect with each other. And another important part that this haptic communication has played is that earlier many people who were not expert in verbal communication and were very much hesitant to express their love or their feelings towards anyone, they were not able to communicate that. And this haptic communication has eased that communication through different types of texts or different types of emojis. Look at the emojis that is present in WhatsApp. If you are angry, so you are not saying that I am angry, main tumse naraaz hoon. No, just you send that and people will understand, okay, this is happening. So the feeling, it is also generating a feeling and it is connecting your relationship with that person. So studies have confirmed that haptic communication influences the romance, the sex, and sexting also has become a very routine and regular expression of sexuality among the teenagers and also the more aged groups. The method that I have used in this study, that I adopted a deep interview and with the people, I talked to around 50 random people and I asked about that, are they in relationship or are they are using a smartphone, they are connected with internet. So after contacting many of them, only 10 were able to tell me about their relationship status and how the smartphone is helping or helped to develop their relationships. So in my this section analysis and discussion, I will talk five stories where people told me about how their sexuality or their love relationship has developed and with the help of smartphones. So the first thing, that is the induction of a new relationship. So smartphones or haptic communication is helping the induction of a new relationship. And an expression of feeling of love involves a risk to be vulnerable to rejection. So earlier, what normally in my class, I remember a story when there was a student and he used to love a girl, but he was not able to express his love towards a girl. So he was using me. He said, no, Vivek, you go and say that I like her. So he was making the medium. Now the medium, nobody is required here. Only you have the phone, you have the contact number, and just you are texting. It's okay. So haptic communication removes the fear, and then now person knows, okay, if what will happen if that girl rejects. Okay, it's okay. I will fill up on another profile. I will look into that things. So it is very much helpful for induction of new relationships. There is a couple, they were in early 30s, they told me about the story, how they got connected. So these people were telling me that we were very happily married for 3 years and our marriage happened by sheer fluke. They were in same college, senior and junior, from the same department, but they never interacted with each other. 5 years later, the girl's friend, he created a WhatsApp group and he included both of them in that WhatsApp group. And after that, through WhatsApp group, they started chatting. Personal chat started and they developed relationships. They further get married. Now they have child and now they are living happily. So this way, a new type of relationship has developed. While in reality, those people never contacted while they were 2 years in same college, same department. So this thing happened. And second one is like practicing love through haptic communication. And in our India, we all know that dating over a smartphone is very common nowadays. And people often search for soulmate who won't judge or label them for initiating a relationship, exploring their sexuality. So there is a story about Kanchan. She is a widow. So, and she had told me about this story of hers, wherein she told that while she has a husband, she was not communicating to many people, she was not having also the smartphones. But after her husband expired, so she felt very much lonely, and in her society people were not allowing her to contact to any man. If she used to contact to any man or talking to any man, people used to say different things to her. So some of her friend told her that you should start using the smartphone. You should log in to Facebook or use different types of applications. She started that, and slowly she developed so many friends. She was telling me, I have thousands of friends in my Facebook, and nobody knows me in my family, that I talk to different types of men who are from different areas. So this way, the expression of a love relationship, expression of feelings, and transcending the social boundaries, the physical boundaries, has enabled that woman to develop relationship, and the fluid social boundaries in urban area also, they get pushed, further facilitated by tacit connections among people conducted over haptic technology. Next one is also this transient relationship. It is also about connection with haptic technology, that the relationships nowadays are more transient, and people idealize love, but growing individualization and transient relationships have compelled people to focus on satisfaction rather than compromising their comfort for maintaining a relationship. And this is a story of Saurabh. So he was boasting his different type of activity over social media. He told me that haptic communication is a form of sexual liberation. It has helped me a lot in making girlfriends one after another. There are lots of dating apps available in the market, like Tinder, Truly Madly, OkCupid, Happy. One can easily create a profile and let him explore some profile matching to his habits and likes. The most significant part of this dating app is that everyone there knows about the purpose of their presence. One need not to develop a proper background before coming to the main point of the purpose while initiating conversation with someone. Flip and click through several profiles, make multiple proposals simultaneously. Those who respond to our proposals are our point of attraction, and we develop discourses. Through our conversation, we come to know a lot about other persons and decide our future course of interaction with that person. If liked, move on, disliked, move on too. It makes life much easier without any preoccupation of sorrow or delight. And I had some of my intimate encounters solely through such applications. So he says that smartphone do create a favorable environment to keep multiple relationships flourish simultaneously without any hindrance of time and space. So transitory spaces of love is a reality of communication mediated by haptic devices, and large options of getting into multiple hookups create sort of like situation where a young boy is expending his sexual energy untapped and uncontrolled. And fourth one, another story is like liberated sexuality, where Anis is a young boy in his late 20s, and he works in a multinational company. He's a gay. So he was telling his experiences of the city Delhi, how it was earlier pre-haptic communication uses and how it changed after that, wherein he told that haptic communication provide meaning of absolute freedom to explore my sexuality and commit to relationship crossing spatial boundaries. Earlier, I used to feel threatening to express my inclination in front of anyone face to face. I used to be afraid of backlash. My job profile allowed me to contact multiple people daily, but I could not express my feelings in front of them. So while expressing my desire to someone through phone application does not make me frightened. Like in earlier session, the same person was telling that he used different type of identities through Facebook and he contacted different people. Earlier he was feeling threatened. So same story is like this one. So he says that the meaning of Delhi, meaning of his city, meaning of his space has completely transformed now due to the use of this communication. So it is like emancipative life for the people. And these mobile haptic devices are like vehicle of change. And last one is that extra connection. A recent article I read in the Hindu, dated 9th December, which has a title article, The Polymery and Open Secret. And this article takes one into world of people who used to feel isolated and socially stigmatized. But after getting information about people with similar ideology, they started forming a community with confidence. This group was named Polyamorous Group. There were multiple groups within the word polyamory over social media. And polyamory is an open relationship wherein a person committed to a relationship explores and indulges in multiple relationships, either emotionally or physically, or both through mutual consent of all the parties involved. So there is a story about the Prabhat and Neelam, who are a married couple in their early 40s. They are into polyamorous relationship with multiple partners around the India. They actively use social media to solicit their new connection with people, and husband performs an active role, arranges partners for a wife and himself. So they involved in all types of sexual relationships. Dinesh in his late 20s and lives in Delhi. So Dinesh was telling me how this contact he contacted with these people. So he told me that once I was scrolling my Facebook timeline and I received a message in my inbox from an unknown middle-aged man complimenting me over recent profile pic. I thanked him and exchanged greetings. He used to like my photos, tell me that his wife likes my photographs very much, and I used to thank him. Then further he told me that this way he started connecting that person, that Dinesh, to her wife. And finally, when they expressed their feelings about that person, and he invited Dinesh to come to their house and have some happy times or enjoyment, then Dinesh came to know about it, and while he refused these things, but it happened. So this type of intimacies, they developed through this haptic communications. So haptic communication is characterized by power to shape our perception and society, and development in communication mediums has given rise to plastic sexuality. Plastic sexuality is related to enhanced freedom of expression of sexuality in our modern society. And haptic communication has availed enhanced options of choosing partners for sexual satisfaction for Prabhat and Neelam. They could solicit new potential partners safely in their houses in Chamba. They live in Himachal Pradesh. For Prabhat, Facebook acted as technology of the self through which he could facilitate and broaden their networks. So finally, in conclusion, I can say that the love is liquid, while which has always engaged into exploring new ways of expression and by exploitation of the existing resources. And evolving communication technology keeps providing more specialized instrument to the individuals to participate in complex networks of relationship and transform their social organization. And people are more prone to loosening grip over their controls. They experiment and explore their sexuality through free mediums provided by this haptic communication. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vivek, for the interesting presentation on love and haptic spaces. Now, it's very interesting. The chair is now going to present, which usually doesn't happen that way. But I'm going to start my presentation on Calcutta, which is called Digital Cartographies and the Encountering and Experiencing of the City. Now, before I start my presentation, just let me very briefly locate my study, which is an ongoing project that I have, which I started pretty recently. And what it does is that it tries to ask three particular questions. The first question that it tries to address is that how do you digitally experience or encounter the city? That's the first question that it tries to ask. The second question that many of us in this panel has been trying to understand is the relationship that we share as humans with the digital medium and the technology in itself. And the third is, which I primarily focus on, and if I can, I would bring that in, is this whole means of knowledge production. How you are being in the city and how you are producing knowledge through the digital medium. And the question is, who is producing this knowledge? What is the form of knowledge that is being produced? What are the forms of it being produced, and what is the location of the knowledge that is being produced? Now, primarily, my study is, I work on digital and I'm terribly inept at it. Okay. Yeah. I'll skip the theory. Acha. Yeah. Okay. I'll skip the theoretical part of it, but I'll just come very quickly to what I'm trying to do with this particular study. Especially, I've come back from field work just now, and I've coming in for the conference after I've come back from my field. Now, the idea is here, what I try to explore is I'm trying to look at how Kolkata is being digitally mapped. Okay, and in digital mapping, what I'm looking at is, I'm not just talking about any Kolkata, I fix a time period, I look at the colonial Kolkata or the colonial past of Kolkata. And I'll come in a bit as to why I want to look at colonial Kolkata. The other thing is that I look at this digital construction primarily through Facebook. And I look at Facebook groups which actually are producing a certain kind of knowledge around Kolkata. Now, when I say I'm looking at Kolkata and Calcutta and Kolkata, primarily and its digital past or the colonial past, is because when we look at technology, what technology does is, as you know, to a great extent, what Kriti has been talking about, even what Vivek has been talking about, is that it often, we assume when we talk about digital, we automatically assume a futuristic kind of an assumption around it. We connect the digital to the future. There's somebody called Vijay Shroff who comes and makes a comment that, you know, that's why Kolkata in old days were known as ditchers. How many know of it today? I absolutely had no idea that we were called ditchers. I never knew that the Lower Circular Road was a ditch in the first place. Lower Circular Road was Lower Circular Road. So, you know, you imagine that in everyday, you know, it's these interesting kinds of constant knowledge production are being taking place. Now, and as I said, you know, it's not just knowledge production, but the forms of knowledge production that are taken. You will see that most, this is again from Kolkata Photographs and Memories, and we see this series of postcards about Kolkata. This is the writer's building, if you know, where the earlier the CPM government housed itself for 35 years, and then Mamata Banerjee came in and shifted the main offices outside in a modern posh building. But this is writer's building built by the British. Okay, and this is a postcard which creates writer's building around 18th century. Similarly, if you look at it, this is Esplanade area, where again, this is a postcard made during that point of time. And this is another postcard which is talking about the area in Bara Bazaar, which is a wholesale market area. Now again, the postcards could actually be a kind of a knowledge production which could actually show us what 17th century, 18th century and 19th century Kolkata was really like. And all of a sudden what we discovered was that the Victoria Memorial had a huge collection of company artists depicting these postcards. Subsequently, somebody came across this particular website in Zurich where a museum was made where a collection of travelers coming in from Europe, non-British travelers, particularly Belgian, and a particular name was Solvin, who came into Kolkata around 18th century and had a series of postcards made around Kolkata around the 18th century time period. So again, if you look at it, it's this digital. I have been to Victoria Memorial, never knew the existence of such collection of postcards. It has made me realize that, you know, there is this whole set of knowledges which are around there again. Again, if you look at this, this is very interesting. This is another kind of a, what happens is once these kinds of posts comes through, you can really see how people actually actively go and try to rediscover. So it's the real time meeting the past. Where if you see, this is the Tagore Castle. This is the home of the family home of Rabindranath Tagore. And this castle was built around the design of the Windsor Castle. The first picture is the Windsor Castle in its original form, and this was built around in, I think, early 1900. And the latter photograph is something around 2012. Okay, you can see again this another angle in which the earlier Windsor Castle is being photographed and the current, the Tagore Castle being photographed and the current Tagore Castle being photographed again. So again, the existence of the Tagores building a Windsor Castle is actually removed from the popular memory of the people of Kolkata. When we talk about the Tagores who lived and prospered in Kolkata, we talk about Jorashako. But we never talk about the Tagore Castle, which was built built in the style of the Windsor Castle. So again, if you look at the digital medium, it is in a very interesting way producing a past through the present. Again, this is very quickly, I will move through. This is Chitpur Road, again a major road in Kolkata. And once this photograph came in, again a sort of a then and a now, where again the roads of Chitpur Road was being discovered. And this is Kumortoli, which is one of the most popular neighborhoods in terms of where still much of the Durga idols are made. So this community came in with while the Kolkata was being made, and they're still around. So if you look at much of the Facebook posts on Kolkata, even individual posts, you would find that there is this whole photo walk kind of a, you know, venture of experiencing and encountering the city, where people keep on going into these localities and photographing these localities. Yeah, I'll just quickly wrap up. Again, I won't go into this. So this entire, you know, this is a Chinese temple in Kolkata. Again, the existence of this Chinese temple in Kolkata is completely wiped out from the current imagination of Kolkata. You know, hardly the Chinese temple is ever talked about. There is another Chinese temple in Tangra, which is outside, not the old Chinatown. This is part of the old Chinatown, which is connected to the Chitpur Road that I showed. The other Chinese temple is outside in the new Chinatown, which is there. But this is hardly ever talked. This has now been revived, interestingly, and they have attached a Chinese restaurant to it, and the whole place has taken on a new kind of a meaning and a new kind of a presence. So this is the mess house where a different kind of knowledge being produced. This is, if you've seen the film Bomkesh Bokshi, I don't know. This is where Shorodindu, the writer of Bomkesh Bokshi, stayed here. And it's the first story he wrote out from here in one of the messbari of Kolkata. Again, this was a member of the group goes out, who is an intense Bomkesh fan, goes into this neighborhood, finds and locates this particular house, photographs it, documents it, and puts there in the public domain to making us recollect and reconnect to our pasts. So, as I said, when you talk about haptics, the idea is not just encountering, but the idea is of reconnecting, not just to a future and a present, but then reconnection can take place at multiple levels. The reconnection also takes in terms of what you have left behind, your past as well. So if you look at the digital medium, I think what we never talk about the digital medium is we've all, through the digital medium, we've suddenly hit upon an era of nostalgia. What is Facebook? I mean, if you look at it, you have these friends group. You look at WhatsApp, and you look at the nature of the WhatsApp groups that we have. It's the school group. It's the college group. It's these people who have lost contact with over 20 odd years, 25 odd years. I've come into Bangalore and I met up my friend yesterday, no, not yesterday, day before yesterday, after 25 years. And thanks to WhatsApp, because it's the school group that we had, we left school and no, we never got in touch. So again, it's this nostalgia, if you look at it, we're often revisiting the places that we've left behind. The pace of our lives and the pace that the technology has brought in, it's interesting how that same technology is reconnecting us to our past. With that, I'll finish my presentation and open the floor for questions. Thank you. Take a couple of questions and then we allow the panelists to answer them. Are they on?
Question is, Vivek, what I felt was that you tried to present the digital as extremely emancipatory, utopic location, which I feel it naively maps the sexual in the digital. A, it's my observation and you can contest it. And I say this particularly because you do not actually deal with how the sexual is transacted in any space, be it physical or digital. Because sexual is not transacted by sexual. Sexual is transacted by anything but sexual, which is through gender, through class, caste, etc. So I feel that your digital as emancipatory does not bring about the contested nature of the space that you're talking about. That possibly the romantic intimate spaces that you're talking about are actually contested spaces, which again leads me to another aspect of bringing in Butler here and talking about performativity, that some extent it also appears that the spaces that you're talking about, the space of intimacy, are performative spaces, right? That they build on the fragility of those haptic interactions that you're talking about. That how, in what modes you link or reach out to anybody, you present yourself, negotiate the sexual, transact in its way, its form, it is through the fragility of it. That it's not necessary that it would translate into the physical and vice versa in the similar way that you are neatly talking about. Right. I also think, if you could also elaborate upon the nature of the intimate spaces that you talk about. What is the nature of such spaces? And I agree to the fact that digital allows challenging of marriage, property, pity, etc., which is cool, like polyamory, sexuality, sexual freedom, and whatever. But don't you think it also helps reproduce existing social hierarchies? So what this complete distinction of it's so difficult to find intimacies in everyday life, in the physical world, and suddenly the digital happen and the world changes drastically. Whom does it change for? Does it change for everybody?
My question is about the politics of touch, which you discussed, but I'm wondering if the politics of touch in India can ever be discussed without talking about caste, and how caste might figure into this idea of touch, or those who cannot be or are not touched. And I also wonder if the relationship between technology and touch is not more complicated, in the sense that couldn't you have situations where people will touch people on screens that they would not touch in real life, for many reasons like class or caste, or gender. And also, following the idea of touch, also I wonder specifically in relation to sexuality and gender, if touch can also be an act of violence.
To answer to your questions, you're talking about that the sexual emancipation that I am talking about, and I agree that there are multiple layers, and it cannot be like just if we are connected with some applications and we contacted a different person and he responded. It is not like completely simple thing, but it is there. Like when we discuss about different layers, multiple layers within same relationship. And the class, the gender, different things, they come into existence. And when we interact with each other, it happens. But there is another thing that I was talking, is that we can skip to another. If we want something, we want to connect with someone, but we can skip through that, and we can transcend to different personality, different people. We can transcend that circle. And there are risks, absolutely there are risks for encountering people from different backgrounds, like you were discussing in your presentation, like people from Dalit caste are not getting that emancipatory spaces or social media or haptic communication, like you yourself change your identity when you created your ID. So these things happens, but what I was talking about, that these things happening, but it is a different direction. My focus was more on the role that this haptic communication is creating and how it is helping the people for developing or progressing their relationships. There are multiple forms in it, but that things cannot be ignored, and both these things are existing, and we have to deal with it accordingly. And these both things, like I told you, I discussed it in my presentation, like the physical space and the virtual space, the things that are happening over physical space, we negotiate with those things. Similarly, we negotiate in our virtual spaces. Whether we are negotiating with these things through our real IDs or different type of IDs, but we are negotiating, and we negotiate and we get through that. That's the
Hi, thank you for a question. So regarding politics of touch, I haven't explored it in this way because I'm talking about an evolutionary stage, because right now it is somewhat more existential. It is more a part of an individual self. So I have not explored into the politics of touch because I also didn't find it, apt to explore in the way in which I wanted to explore it. Now you asked about touch as an act of violence. I have not explored touch as act of violence because I have, in the start of my presentation, talked about unslash touch, in which I am explicitly stating that, you know, even if we are touching or getting connected with people through touch, touch in the sense of sensory of touch, touch in the sense of technology, we are still untouched physically. Like, there is no physical touching happening. And since I'm actually exploring this as a, in the form of Homo haptics, where it is a technique man, so I haven't explored this act of violence. Maybe I will explore it at a later stage. Another question that you posed was that, you know, sometimes we may touch people digitally, but in real time or real life, we may not touch them. I think I agree with you to an extent, because, you know, there is a certain level of vulnerability when we say that, you know, Homo haptics has emerged. And if we see the kind of cyber violence that is taking place, it is exactly that. So therein comes your act of violence, therein comes your, you know, you're touching someone digitally, but you are not touching someone in the physical sense of the word. So I guess I do agree with you on that aspect. As I said, I haven't explored this part because I'm not looking at it in that way. I'm looking at the haptics of touch or Homo haptics in a way that, you know, it has become an innate part of the self. Like, our very being is now mediated through this touch. So whether or not we like someone or we don't like someone, as Vivek pointed out, right? So like on dating apps like Tinder or something, so you're flipping through people. Whether you like them or don't like them, you're still touching them in a way, right? So you have to flip them. Even if you want to decline a call from someone, you have to touch to decline, right? It's not going to happen. Either you touch it or either you, you know, give a voice command. So in a way, I think it becomes slightly complicated when we are bringing this touch technology into, you know, how the sensory of touch is being played out in real time and in digital time. And to state and to further complicate is that, you know, even if we are saying, you know, digitally we are touching you, and in reality we are not, but if you look at it, in reality you have actually touched someone, even through the digital platform, so to say. So I wasn't able to actually bring these points out because of shortage of time, as usual. So that's it. I think I've answered your questions.
I will also add one more point to this act of violence, the touch as an act of violence. I think this touch becomes an act of violence when we look into this direction, like cyberbullying. It is an act of violence. We are touching, we are talking to the people. Some people, when they are denying, they don't want to interact with you, but again and again people are doing that. So it is like cyberbullying. Or through that touch, like a girl has created his Facebook ID, her Facebook ID, and you use that Facebook photographs and DP for some other purposes. So it is an act of violence which is being communicated through the touch. And there was also, I was reading a story when a girl and a man, they were interacting for some times, 1 month, 2 months, and they both were using fake IDs and fake photographs for them. So one day the man asked the girl to talk to her through video call. Okay, when they started doing the video call, then they both came to know, they were shocked that the girl was the daughter of the man. The father and the daughter were talking through their video calling. So it was like a violated act. They violated reality. In reality, their relationship got violated. While in virtual space, it was not like that. So this interaction sometimes acts as a violent form of violence.
Thank you. And with that, Solly, a few words if you would like to wrap up.
Wrap up, but thank you. But given the at one level, there's a kind of diversity of the presentations, but on another, in some sense, I think they both talked about this tension between the sort of material and how that gets into. I mean, I'm thinking of what Prasad and Rupali termed at the end of their presentation, that we are all on some kind of trip. So just on that note, thank you all very much. Now, if you all touch your cell phones, you will soon realize, and hold it for 5 seconds, you'll soon realize that through the second level of dreaming, we are going to be moved in the Elysium style to Lamington Road 20 years in the hence. So thank you all very much. I hope you've all seen Elysium. Okay, bye.